Welcome to the Community Shares SECA charity presentation. I'm going to talk for a couple minutes first about the SECA campaign. SECA is the state employee combined appeal. It allows state employees to support the causes that they care about. It offers the convenience of making charitable donations via payroll deduction. And you have the choice of hundreds of charities, including Community Shares and our members, but also a variety of other federations and their member organizations. You can view all of your charitable options and the charitable listing guide at secaillinois.org. The 2020 campaign incentives are available for any donor who makes a donation over $2 per pay period or more than $48 total. If you do that, you're entered into a drawing for one of $500 gift cards or one of 10 $50 gift cards. And that drawing will take place after January 1st. In addition, for viewing our presentation today, you get entered into a drawing for one of four $25 gift cards. There'll be a link at the end of the presentation. So if you watch it all the way through, you'll be able to go to that link and enter your name for a gift card. Community Shares of Illinois is a charitable federation. We support 45 organizations, and we connect you as a donor with opportunities to create change in your community. And many of our members are working hard to change minds, change laws, and change lives throughout our state. We support a variety of cause areas, from housing, supporting veterans, empowering women, children, and families, fostering arts and culture, creating a just society, improving health and nutrition, and promoting animal welfare. We have six member organizations who are joining us today. Arts of Life, Forever Home Feline Ranch, Champaign County Humane Society, Community Organizing and Family Issues, South Suburban Housing Center, and Urbana-Champaign Media Center. And a shout out as well to Illinois Now Legal and Education Fund, who is just popping in to join us as well. So I'm going to let Anne from Arts of Life go ahead and tell us a little bit about her organization.
I was muted, sorry. Hi, I'm Anne with Arts of Life. As our mission says, we advance the creative arts community by providing artists with intellectual and developmental disabilities a collective space to expand their practice and strengthen their leadership. I highlighted the words community and leadership because those are two of the core components of our program that I wanted to highlight as I talk about what we do today. In essence, what we do is run an art studio for adult artists with intellectual and developmental disabilities. We support 60 artists in two studios and galleries, one in Chicago and one in Glenview, Illinois. To give you a little bit of context of what we're trying to do, the state of Illinois is consistently ranked in the bottom five of all 50 states year after year after year for the supports that they provide to our residents with disabilities. What that means in practice is that residents are in a lottery system and sometimes wait years to get any kind of support, and that a lot of the programs are outdated and very restrictive. We strongly believe that our, not just artists, but all residents with disabilities should have access to meaningful activities. They should have access to community, and that those things shouldn't be in the same place as their residential setting. I think for many of us who have seen our lives shrink a lot during COVID, that idea of having a life outside of where you live is really important. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about our approach. As I said, meaningful vocational opportunities to us means that our artists are professional artists. We support them in their art making. We also provide them with professional development opportunities. So if they want to sell their work, if they want to collaborate, if they want to exhibit their work, learn how to curate their own exhibitions, teach, learn how to speak in public, we provide them with supports to help to gain those skills and make that possible. We really push for independence and self-respect, meaning that we want each artist and each staffer to be doing as much as they are able to do, and to respect themselves, be proud of themselves, and of everyone else. We really believe in community. That is the community of peers, them, you know, the artists getting to work together, but also in bringing in hundreds of volunteers, collaborators, partners, art buyers, to help to build a robust community and also increase the recognition of our artists in the broader community. And we really focus on collective decision-making. It's a core component of our program, which means that every person in our organization, including the artists, has a vote and a voice in everything that we do. So our artists on a monthly basis vote on who we hire, our programming, the kinds of parties we throw. From big to small, they're involved in the decision-making. And I have seen firsthand how their voices can help to shift the focus of our organization over the 20 years that we've been in existence so far. I know that you have a lot of causes, a lot of great charities to be considering, so I wanted to give you a little bit of a sense of what you're helping to do and make possible if you support us. So, as I mentioned, in this new reality, we've had to go to kind of a hybrid model, and we've been seeing a lot of our funding sources shrink as a result. So you are helping to make up the gaps that exist in us being able to provide transportation to our artists to get them to the studio if they are able, to provide art supplies and studio space. For those who can't come into the studio right now, we are delivering supplies and equipment to artists at home so that they can stay involved and connected. It supports the staff support that's needed to cultivate those relationships for collaboration, but also physical supports. So when I talked about the independence of our artists, some are fully independent physically, and in every sense, and others need help with special equipment to make their art, with help in communicating, and even help with going to the bathroom. And we provide all of those supports as needed in studio. And it also provides support for our virtual programming and our kind of hybrid programming. So we now are providing our artists with iPads and the Zoom program so that they can be participating, whether they're at home or in person, in all of our clubs and programs and workshops to keep them connected, because really we're trying to keep them from being isolated and keep them connected no matter where they are. I thank you so much for your consideration, and I'm happy to answer questions later on.
Thanks, Anne. Our next member up today is Vera from Forever Home Feline Ranch.
Good morning. My name is Vera Mount, and I retired 10 years ago after a 32-year career with the state, and since that time, I have self-titled as feline philanthropist, and I am luckily rescued by a 14-year-old black domestic male cat named Judo and an 8-year-old Siamese named Jackie. This presentation begins as a vision of what two crazy cats imagined as a mission to eliminate euthanasia as the first form of population control in the feline community. Forever Home Feline Ranch was the brainchild of local ladies Cheryl Johnston, co-founder and current president, and Brenda Barton. In March 2009, they began fostering in Brenda's home with the vision of securing property for a no-cage, no-kill sanctuary. A board was formed, and through community fundraising and networking, they were successful in securing an over 10-acre property in Chester, Illinois. The cats living in Brent's property and in various fosters, February 2013. The property has separate areas for special needs cats, such as those with communicable diseases, such as herpes, an upper respiratory disease, and a cabin for FIV positive cats. 50% of cats at the ranch are adoptable, while the other 50% are considered sanctuary cats who will live out their lives at the ranch. Kittens and other adoptable cats are placed in other foster homes throughout the community. Forever Home Feline Ranch is run by a working board and by volunteers. There are full-time caretakers who are responsible for daily maintenance of the building and grounds and basic care of the cats in exchange for rent. Since its inception in 2009, over 2,600 cats and kittens have been adopted and fostered. Through donations and fundraisers, the property is now paid in full future fundraising will offer plans for expansion. Because the ranch exists solely on donations and fundraisers, workplace giving campaigns such as SECA are critical. The pandemic creates big challenges in creating events that are socially distanced. One campaign that's currently active is called Making a Change. Offices can request a change jar to be delivered for employees to donate their spare change. These funds will be dedicated to expenses, in particular for spaying and neutering. The document on our slideshow that has our donation code demonstrates how quickly just one unspayed cat adds to the homeless population. Theoretically, in an average lifetime, one unspayed female cat could produce up to 180 kittens in her lifetime. If your office would consider a collection jar, please send a message on our Facebook page or email from our website or call. I will be happy to deliver at a socially distanced location, and I'll wear a mask. Within this week, the ranch has two other events within the community we would like to promote. This Saturday, October 3rd, from 1:30 to 5 p.m., we will have adoptable cats and kittens and a donation jar at our Brews and Muse event at Buzz Bomb Brewing on Adams Street. The whole block is dedicated for a socially distanced opportunity to enjoy some great local craft beer, meet and greet the volunteers, make a donation, and possibly deliver home to a furry feline. Masks and social distancing will be required at our tables and when ordering beer. On Monday, October 5th, Monocle's Pizza has chosen the ranch as their selected organization for Community Day. They will donate 20% of your bill before tax for dine-in or carry-out on that day. A downloadable flyer is available on our website and must be presented for us to get their contribution. Lastly, and very importantly, Forever Home Feline Ranch is run entirely by volunteers. One of our dedicated volunteers, Dawn Scott, has gone above and beyond during the pandemic by distributing cat food and litter requested through a local Facebook page and also has restocked local micro pantries throughout town. She was recognized as a local hometown hero. If you can't help with a financial contribution, there are many opportunities to volunteer listed on our website. Thank you so much, Carrie, for the opportunity to participate in this virtual charity fair. To the entire SECA board, ambassadors, and state employees and retirees for giving consideration to support Forever Home Feline Ranch during this year's very different campaign.
Thank you, Vera. Our next member is Emily from COFI.
Good morning, everyone. So at Community Organizing and Family Issues, AKA COFI, our mission is to build the power and voice of low-income families at all levels of civic life. So we do this by working with parents, mostly moms, but some fathers, and doing leadership development training so that parents feel able and supported to become stronger advocates for their families and fight for better schools and communities. Training takes place at schools and in community spaces across the state. Normally, it's virtual right now. But so our kind of theory is that we start at the individual level and then you kind of build outwards. So we start working with leaders as they identify how they're a leader and looking within themselves. The next level is at their school. So all these new parent leaders kind of come together, they identify an issue and they advocate for change. So one example, if you see the bottom right corner of our screen, parents at one school on the southwest side of Chicago, there was this really incredibly busy, dangerous road right next to the school. So they talked to other parents at the school, they talked to the principal and community members, and they advocated, and they won a stop sign just to make it safer for students to be able to get to school. The next step is kind of working across communities in an organization called PowerPack Illinois. So there are 8 branches across the state. There's 4 in Chicago, 1 in Evanston, Elgin, Aurora, and East St. Louis, working again on issues that are important to families, like access to early learning opportunities, working towards economic justice for families, addressing health disparities for children in under-resourced communities. And during COVID, an especially important one is remote learning and addressing the digital divide. So in our 25-year history, just a few of our major victories have been bringing back recess for Chicago public school students, replacing zero tolerance punishment with restorative justice in the school code, and training over 500 parents in restorative justice practices, expanding SNAP benefits to 40,000 more Illinois families, and reaching out to over 100,000 parents about early learning resources. And quickly, I just want to highlight one of our parent leaders. Liliana Alayo is a mother of three and a COVID-trained parent leader. She emigrated from Mexico to Aurora in 1991. She's been involved with COVID for a few years now. She started doing training at her children's school. So she works as a COFI peer ambassador, sharing information and resources with other Aurora families. She's a co-president of PowerPack, and she's a head of the Bilingual Parents Council at her children's school. And she's just a great example of our kind of goals at COFI, which is to support parents to have a voice in the decisions that affect their families. So supporting COFI will go to supporting this parent training, which, as you can see, has this very wide ripple effect for families across the state. Thank you for your consideration, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thanks, Emily. Our next presenter is Mackenzie from South Suburban Housing Center.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for having us here to take the opportunity to discuss our agency and what we do and what our impact is. So we are South Suburban Housing Center. We are a regional fair housing enforcement and HUD-approved housing counseling agency. A little bit of history. In 1975, we were formed by several groups of the League of Women Voters that wanted us to monitor and address discriminatory real estate practices in the south suburbs of Chicago. From there, we started as an enforcement agency as well as a housing counseling agency, affirmatively promoting communities and providing resources to individuals that were looking to relocate from the south side of Chicago into the south suburbs of Chicago. In the mid-80s, we added pre-purchase classes and home buyer education courses to educate the public about proper home purchase. And in 2009, we were certified in foreclosure counseling to help combat the housing crisis of 2008. So currently, we seek to promote and foster long-term diversity through all of the communities in our service area, which is primarily South Cook, but we also help out Lake County, Indiana, as well as more southern counties of Illinois. And we work to eliminate all forms of discrimination and exploitation in the housing market. The numbers that you see on the screen are a little snapshot of the work that we did in 2019. On the fair housing enforcement side, we were able to intake and process 216 fair housing complaints for race, disability, familial status, national origin, and source of income discrimination claims in 2018. And we were also able to conduct 152 fair housing test part investigations. Essentially what that means is, as a fair housing enforcement agency, we take complaints from individuals and protected class members that feel that they were discriminated against in any housing transaction. That could mean being denied when you're trying to rent an apartment because of your race. It could also mean being denied having an emotional support animal if you're someone with a disability. On the housing counseling side, we had a great year in 2019. We were able to counsel 626 families, and 54% of those were seeking mortgage foreclosure delinquency assistance, and 46 of them were for pre-purchase, resulting in 36 new homeowners. We also participated in the Illinois Hardest Hit Program, where we were able to fund $14,845,554 awarded to families that were struggling to make their mortgage payments. Looking to this year, obviously, we're doing outreach a little bit differently, like we are right now. And in response to COVID-19, there were several families, so many, that were struggling to meet their rent payments. that were facing evictions from their landlords despite the moratorium, and families that were struggling to stay in their home and keep up with their mortgage payments. So the Illinois Housing Development Authority did release a program in August of 2020 called the Emergency Rental and Mortgage Assistance Programs. And we were assisted as community partners to provide outreach and intake for applicants. So during just the month of August, we helped out 484 clients with their application by phone, in person, via social distance for those that don't have access to technology, which is especially a problem in lower income communities. We did also did these things via email and over the phone. We were able to reach 214,000 people through Facebook and trying out some new ways to digitally reach people and let them know that this funding was available to them should they be eligible. And we were able to distribute almost 5,000 flyers across the south suburbs to make sure that we got the word out. So when you donate to South Suburban Housing Center, you're helping to bridge some inequality gaps, fight housing discrimination, and empower communities to become homeowners and build wealth. And that's just a little bit about us. So.
Thank you, Mackenzie. Our next speaker is from the Urbana-Champaign Independent Media Center.
Hi everyone, my name is Miriam Larson and I'm the Executive Director at the Urbana-Champaign Independent Media Center in Urbana-Champaign, Illinois, downstate a little bit, but it sounds like we have some folks who work with communities across the state of Illinois, so I just want to appreciate everyone else that's on here. It's really neat to hear about everyone's work. Here at the IMC, as we call it for short, we foster the creation and distribution of media, art, and narratives emphasizing underrepresented voices and perspectives, and promote empowerment and expression through media and arts education. We are also, like some of the other organizations on the call, largely volunteer run. I'm the only staff person here at the IMC. And we just finished paying off our mortgage for the post office building. So we rent to the post office in downtown Urbana and then use the rest of the venue for artist studio and office space rentals, as well as a performance venue. Of course, during COVID, that's been a little bit more challenging. So I want to bring some attention to the other working group activities that we have going on in the IMC. So Carrie, if you would go to the next slide for me. We have a handful of working groups that are entirely volunteer run independent projects, and WRFU 104.5 radio is in the time of COVID one working group that has really been able to thrive and serve the community. In March, we had a community member and dentist pass away from COVID, and one of the things WRFU was able to do was put a playlist of his favorite music on, so that a parade of cars driving by his widow's house could play some of his favorite music. And so we were able to interrupt the regularly scheduled broadcast to do that for our community. Public Eye Newspaper has been able to provide COVID information to the community, is a source for citizen journalism, and continues to publish print newspapers as well as online content. Books to Prisoners is a program that sends books to folks that are incarcerated. And one of their recent projects, which is exciting, is to collaborate with an online newspaper called Unity in Action to publish some work by folks that are incarcerated, publish some writings and poetry, so that they can have their voices heard. Makerspace Urbana is a community-run makerspace with everything from 3D printers to sewing machines. The Zine Library is a local resource that collects all kinds of sort of handmade magazines that folks make, and then also does workshops. And our final working group is Sounds Like Community, which was started right after the pandemic hit. It's a weekly virtual program that combines artists and activists and via Zoom presentations helps us gather. So that's a little bit about the work of the Independent Media Center. Not only do I want to encourage you to consider supporting us financially, but if you are in the area or really anywhere across the state of Illinois, you're welcome to get involved. Our mission commitment is really to see everyone as media makers and make sure everyone feels they have a way to be heard and a way to get their message across, because we all have something important to say, and with the corporatization and consolidation of media, I want to make sure that the opportunity to be heard and to have stories told from community members is possible and accessible. So that's a little bit about the Urbana-Champaign Independent Media Center. I hope you'll consider supporting us, and certainly reach out if you have any questions. I'll be around for the Q&A after the other presentations.
Thank you, Miriam. And our final member speaking today is the Champaign County Humane Society.
Hi, my name is Jill, and this is Daniela, our adoption supervisor, who's co-presenting with us. And more importantly, we have a third co-presenter who's right here that I'll let Daniela introduce you all to.
Yeah, this is Amira. She's a 3-month-old kitten that we have up for adoption at the shelter. She's one of probably about 40 cats that we have available for adoption right now. We also have dogs, small animals, and even reptiles at the moment. So we've got a wide variety of pets here.
Yeah, so in addition to talking about what we do here at the Champaign County Humane Society, I thought it would be even more impactful just to show you what we do, and there's nothing better than a kitten to help describe our mission. We are located in Champaign, Illinois, along with a few others like the IMC, which I'm a big fan of. So it's good to see you on the presentation here. And although we are called the Champaign County Humane Society, we don't get any government funding or any funding from national Humane Society organizations. So we're completely funded by individuals like yourselves. So thank you very much for all of your support. Community Shares has been a big supporter of us for many years, and we greatly appreciate it. It makes it so much easier to get these adoptions going in our community and to support our staff and all of our programs because of your support. It's made a huge difference for many years, so thank you. We are a shelter, and we also provide veterinary care to between 1,300 and 1,600 homeless animals per year. So Daniela has been here for
four and a half years.
So how many animals do you think you've adopted over that time?
Probably we average about 1,000 adoptions a year. So, you know, around 4,500 or so, give or take.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's a lot. That's a lot, especially for our small organization here. I know that makes me very proud and very excited to be a part of this team here. In addition, we provide services to support low-income pet owners in the area. And with our veterinary and animal behavior teams, we help animals that other shelters would not be able to help. So we are an open admission shelter. Thank you for considering us for your workplace donation. I know we all appreciate it. Mm-hmm. And if you have any questions, we'll be sticking around after the show. Thank you.
Thank you both. That's the end of our membership presentations. We're opening up the floor now to questions. I also have on the screen the link for the SECA drawing. And for those of you who dialed in by phone, that is http://bit.ly/SECAFair. And if you are joining us online and not able to see us in person, if you're watching this later from the SECA website and you have questions that you're not able to ask today, you're welcome to reach out to us and to our member organizations directly. So for those of us who are on the call today, would anyone like to ask a question of one of our member organizations? You're also welcome to type it into the chat. Andrew, do we have any questions that have popped up?
Not yet.
right. Well, if you do not have questions at this time, again, you're welcome to reach out to us afterwards. Our website is communitysharesillinois.org. We also have links on there to all of our members' websites, so you can access their contact information and talk to them directly. If you have questions, if you want to volunteer, if you want to find out more about any of their programs, all of their donation codes were posted on our slideshow today. Our whole presentation will be posted to the SECAIllinois.org website, so you can go back and view it. Let your coworkers and colleagues know that they can go and view it at any time during the campaign. We thank all of you who joined us today for your time and for supporting our wonderful organizations. SECA employees are incredibly generous, and none of us could do the work that we do without workplace donations from all of you. So thank you very much for joining us. Thank you to all six of our members who were able to join us as well. We appreciate you all.